applications of differential equation continued. Applications of ordinary differential equations continued. Why continued? Because we had already discussed one of the applications, which was orthogonal trajectories. Okay, so we already discussed orthogonal trajectories. So today I'm going to begin with the growth decay problems. The growth and decay problems. Okay, such kind of problems are primarily seen in chemistry also under radioactive decay. Many a times we talk about growth decay problems with respect to population, with respect to growth of money, okay, with decay of radioactive substance. That is why the name of growth and decay has been given to it. So let's quickly start with questions based on the same, because from theory point of view, there is nothing very, very important with respect to theory, because you have already done it. So let's start with a question. This is not ODE. Okay, so let's start with this question. NPS YPR, do you have school tomorrow? Anybody from NPS YPR who can confirm that? Because I remember somebody told me that you have some extra classes. Okay, till 12. Okay, fine. Thank you. All right, so here we have a question. The population of a certain country is known to increase at a rate proportional to the number of people presently living in the country. If after 2 years, the population has doubled, and after 3 years, the population is 20,000, estimate the people initially living in the country. I'll give you an idea how to solve this, but only after you have tried it out, because I just want to give you some time to think over it, how to solve these kind of questions. So the idea is pretty simple. Frame a differential equation. So how is the population changing, the rate at which it is changing? They have already mentioned it to you. So frame a differential equation. I think they have given certain set of boundary conditions also. Utilize it. And then find out how many people were living at time t equal to zero in the country. Once done, you can give me a response on the chat box. So let us say N is the amount of people living in a country, okay, number of people living at time t. Now you have to figure it out, Siddhant. We have to solve the differential equation and check whether it is exponentially related. So what is the first thing that I can say, reading the statement, the population of a certain country is known to increase at a rate proportional to the number of people living in it. So dN by dt is directly proportional to N. Okay. And we can put a proportionality constant K, okay, in place of, okay, that proportionality constant, where K is some positive number. Why positive number? Because the question has categorically mentioned that there is an increase in the population. Okay, so I think we have already formed a differential equation. So this is a simple variable separable. Solve for it and see what do you obtain. So you get dn by n is equal to k dt. Okay, integrate both the sides. So you end up getting ln n is equal to kt plus a c. Okay. Now, few things have been provided to us that after 2 years, the population has doubled. Okay, so now let's do one thing. First of all, at t equal to zero, we know that the population is n zero. Okay, where n zero is the initial population of the country or initial number of people living in the country. Okay, so when t equal to zero, n becomes n naught. Okay, so c becomes ln n naught. Correct. Now place your c as ln n naught and send it to the other side. So ln n minus ln n naught is equal to kt. In short, n by n naught ln of it is equal to kt. Okay. Now let's use the information given to us. After 2 years, the country has doubled. The population of the country has doubled, and after 3 years, it is 20,000. Okay, great. So n is equal to 2n naught when t is equal to 2. Okay, Shitesh has got some answer. Okay, fine. So use this fact over here and you'll end up getting ln 2 is equal to 2k. That means k is equal to half ln 2. Yes or no? Yes or no? Okay. So using this fact again in this expression, what do we get? What is k here? Proportionality constant. Because they just said that it is directly proportional to the population, right? Okay. Yeah. So once you put that value back here, what do you end up getting? You end up getting ln n by n naught is equal to half ln 2 into time. Yes or no? Now they have also mentioned that after 3 years, the population has become 20,000. That means now I'm using a fresh piece of information provided to me that t equal to 3, n has become 20,000. That means if I put it over here, ln n by 20,000, this is half ln 2 into 3. Okay. So let's try to solve this. So this is 3 by 2 ln 2 and this is ln n by 20,000. So n by 20,000 is as good as 2 to the power of 3 by 2. 2 to the power of 3 by 2 is 2 root 2. Oh, I'm so sorry. Other way around. I'm so sorry. This is going to be 20,000 and this is going to be n naught. Yeah. Our agenda was to find out n naught. Yeah. So this is going to be 20,000 and this is going to be n naught. So n naught is going to be 10,000 divided by root 2. Yes or no? Root 2 is roughly 1.4-ish. So if you calculate it, how much does it come out to be roughly? 10,000 divided by root 2. Divided by root 2. Roughly comes out to be 7071 kind of a thing. Is this fine? Any questions? Exactly. So initially somebody gave some 5,000 something. No, acha, 7,061. Number of people are in decimals. You have to approximate it. Okay. It's a rough estimate. Okay. So depending upon the options, of course, options will be significantly different. Okay. It will not be like very close to each other. But always express it to the next, you can say smallest figure, not the highest figure, next smallest figure. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Is the approach clear for this type of question? Okay, we'll try to take one more question. Let's take another one. Okay, I'll be giving a question from my side. Okay, the question is, five mice in a stable population of 500 are intentionally infected with a contagious disease. Okay, just to test the theory of epidemic. Okay, now the rate of change in the infected population is twice the product of the number of mice who have the disease with the number that are disease free. Okay, so I hope this part of the question is clear. So the rate of change of the infected population is the product of the number of mice who have the disease and the number of mice who are disease free. Okay, now how long will it take for 90% of the population to contract the disease. Okay. Time is to be considered in days. Okay. Time to be taken in days. COVID. Is the question clear to you? The question is, initially there were 500 mice present in a stable population. Stable population means this was a healthy population of mice. So what happened is initially five of them were out of that 500, five were intentionally injected with some contagious disease just to check the spread of the, that epidemic. So it was found that the rate at which the change of the infected mice, increased was twice the product of the number of mice who had the disease and the number of mice who were disease free. Okay. How long will it take for 90% of the population to contract that disease? Moro sessions. Moro trading happened yesterday itself, right? 6:15 to 7:15. I don't know whether it's a different calendar that you follow. Yes. Correct. Kshitij. Because once the product will become maximum when the number of infected and non-infected are same. You're absolutely right. And then it'll fall down. Yeah. Okay. Is it coming exactly 6 days? Because, you know, I'm not very sure about the exactness of the answer. Oh, you rounded it off. Okay. Many times for such questions, they will give you some critical values. If at all you are not using, because you will not be allowed to use a calculator. No. So whatever numbers you will be seeing, they'll give you the, you know, values for those numbers. But as of now, if you feel that you need a calculator for calculating something, you may use it, but don't worry, when it comes actually in the examination hall, they will give you some critical values, which will be required in the problem solving. For example, if you need some lawn or something, they'll give you, don't worry. So first frame a differential equation. So I've got one answer so far. We'll wait for others to respond. Okay, should we discuss it now? Anybody who wants me to wait? 30 seconds. Okay, fine. Take 1 minute. Take 1 minute. No worries. In vectors, have you completed dot product, cross product, STP, BTP? Not yet. Okay. Okay, coplanarity of three vectors. And coplanarity of 4 points, those concepts. Linear dependence, non-linear dependence kind of a thing, right? Okay, so here can we say that they have mentioned that the rate of change in the infected population, so let n be the number of mice infected at a given time t. Let n be the number of infected mice at a time t. Okay. So as per the given information, dn by dt is twice the product of the number of mice which are infected and the mice which are not infected. So out of 500, n are infected, so 500 minus n is not infected. So this is the situation given to you at hand. In short, you have been provided with something like this. Okay, so we are separating the variables now, and let's try to apply partial fractions here. So this is going to be, if I'm not mistaken, this is going to be something by 500 n minus n plus something by n. Okay, if I'm not mistaken, I could choose both of them to be 1 by 500, because if I do this, okay, it conveniently gets the n cancelled from here, and 500 also gets cancelled because of this 1 by 500. Okay, so using partial fractions, we can basically write the term on the left hand side to be like this. In short, you are basically trying to, let me write it like this. You are basically trying to integrate this. Dn is equal to 1000 t. 1000 dt. Correct? All right. Let's integrate both the sides. So this is going to give you negative ln 500 minus n plus ln n. This is 1000 t plus c. That means ln of n upon 500 minus n, 1000 t plus c. Okay. Now use the fact that when t equal to 0, the number of mice who were infected by this infectious disease were only 5. Okay. So only 5 mice at t equal to 0 were infected by this infectious or contagious disease. So ln 5 by 495, which happens to be 1 by 99, if I'm not wrong, this is equal to c. Correct? That means c is equal to ln 1 by 99. Okay, so send the c to the other side. So it's ln n by 500 minus n minus ln 1 by 99 is 1000 t. Okay, now this is plain and simple. This is going to be 99 n by 500 minus n. Correct me if I'm wrong. This is equal to 1000 t. Yes. Now, what are they asking? At what time almost 90% of the population will be infected by the disease? So n should become 90% of 500, which is almost 450 mice are now infected. So what is the time at which 450 mice are infected by the disease? Correct. So just put here n value as 450. So it's really 99 into 450 upon 50. Okay, is equal to 1000 t. So this will go by this thing. So the answer will be 1 by 1000 of ln 495. Okay, so how many days it is? Let's check it out. In time, in days, in days. So basically, I'm writing your answer in terms of days. Oh, I'm so sorry. So sorry. This is 9. Yeah. So it'll become 981, isn't it? So as per my phone's calculator, sorry, I'm using the phone because I have not been provided with the value of this. So this will come out to be almost point. Ln of 691 comes out to be 679, almost 6.79. Okay, so it is almost like within this many days. I mean, you can count it in terms of seconds or hours also. within 6.79 to 10 to the power negative 3 days, almost 90% of the population would have got infected by the disease. It's a very, very less time. Okay. So this disease will grow very, very fast. And within this many days, okay, the entire population would have got, 90% of the population would have acquired the disease. Any problem? Everything is fine. Any questions, any concerns? I mean, I have chosen it to be in days. It is like up to me to choose it in seconds also. Because this unit I have to choose. Okay. If you find it in terms of seconds, so in one day, there are 12 into 8,600. Okay. Into 6.79 by 1,000. So almost around in 600 seconds, this comes out to be somewhere around roughly 587 seconds. Okay. So less than 6 minutes, less than 10 minutes, the entire population will be, 90% of the population will be infected. Vaibhav Manigar, you are not paying attention to the question. What did I write over here? Didn't I write in the question, time is to be taken in days? Question setter, it's the prerogative of the question setter to give you the time, right? Whether he's talking about time in days or seconds or minutes. Okay. Clear, Vaibhav Manigar. Yeah. Okay. Next type of question that we are going to talk about is Newton's law of cooling. Now you have already done this in class 11 physics. So the rate at which the temperature of a substance changes is directly proportional to the difference of the temperature with the surrounding temperature. Okay. Now, rate of cooling, when you talk about rate of cooling, the T value is always more than the value of the surrounding, right? So the rate at which the temperature decreases, okay, will be directly proportional to the difference of the temperature of the body with the surrounding temperature. Okay. S is the surrounding temperature. Correct. Now you already know this information from your Newton's law of cooling. Correct, Kinshuk. Kinshuk is surprised. What happened, Kinshuk? Anything that I have written wrong? You asked something. Yes. You can use definite integral from 5 to, yes, absolutely right. That C value that you are finding out, if you can do away with the C value if you put your limits of integration. Definitely you can do that. Okay. Now, please understand here that this situation will be provided to you in your examination, is in your question, because they don't expect you to know this being a math student. Yes, being a physics student, you may be expected to know this beforehand. So please watch out for the information given to you with respect to any cooling or heating related issues. So here I'm assuming that this information would be provided to you. Okay, in the examination, in the question itself, there will be mentioned, this will be mentioned to you. So we'll take a question based on the same. Okay, so let's take a question based on the same. Okay, now let's read this question. The question says a body at a temperature of 50 degree Fahrenheit is placed outdoors, okay, where the temperature is 100 degree Fahrenheit. So now here the heating is happening because the surrounding temperature is more. Okay. So if the rate of change of the temperature of a body is proportional to the temperature difference between the body and the surrounding medium, and if 5 minutes, if after 5 minutes the temperature becomes 60 degree Fahrenheit, then part A of the question is how long will it take the body to reach the temperature of 75 degree Fahrenheit? And part B, how long will the, what will the temperature of the body after 20 minutes? Let's do this. Sorry, Siddhant, I missed your question. Yes, as I already told you in the examination room and the exam, they will be providing you with the required log values of those miscellaneous, you know, log expressions that were coming up. Okay. They don't expect you to remember log and go. Don't worry. Okay, so as per the information given to us, there has to be an increase in the temperature of the body because it is kept in a, medium which is at a higher temperature, right? So let's say T is the temperature of the body at a given time T. Temperature at a time T. So because it is kept in a medium which is at a higher degree temperature, there will be an increase in the temperature of the body with respect to time. So K being the proportionality constant here, K has to be positive. Okay. Or if you want to write T minus 100, like the way I've written over here, then you have to keep your K as a negative. Because overall, there's an increase in the temperature. So once you have obtained this, it's a variable separable. So you can write it like this. Integrate both sides. So this is going to give you negative ln 100 minus T is equal to KT plus C. Correct? Now, as per the question, at T equal to zero, the temperature of the body was 50 degree Fahrenheit. That means negative ln 50 is equal to C. Put it over here back. Okay. So negative ln 100 minus T is equal to K. Yeah, is equal to KT minus ln 50. Okay. So that's going to give you ln of 50 divided by 100 minus T is equal to KT. Now, I need one more piece of information to get my K value. And I think they have already provided us that after 5 minutes, okay, the temperature of the body is 60 degree Fahrenheit. So I'm not taking my unit to be in minutes. So when T is equal to 5, capital T, that is the temperature of the body, becomes 60. Okay. So ln of 50 by 40 is equal to 5k. So k is 1/5 of ln 5 by 4. Put it back over here, and I think that will give you a final relationship between the temperature and the time. So instantaneous temperature and time would be related to each other by this relation. In fact, T by 5, ln 5 by 4. Now, what is the thing that they require? Let's try to figure it out. They're asking us, how long will the body take to reach a temperature of 75? Okay, so what is T when capital T is 75? So when you put it over here, you get ln 2, if I'm not mistaken, because 50 divided by 25 is this. Okay, and T by 5, ln of 5 by 4. Okay. So let's see what we can do with this figure. So as per our expression, it should be 5 ln 2 upon ln of 5 by 4. Again, they have not mentioned us the values. Without that, it will be difficult for us to figure it out. Ideally, they should have given us the values. So again, I'll use my mobile device to find it out. So 5 ln 2, okay, whole divided by ln of 1.25. It comes out to be roughly 15.53. Aditya, your answer is coming very, very different. Shittij and mine is matching. You got the same figures. This figure only came out. Okay, if this figure has come out, then it's fine. No need to worry much. Okay. So this comes out to be roughly 15.53 minutes, 15 and a half minutes, you can say. Okay. All right. So we'll move on to the next part of the question. Next part of the question says the temperature of the body after 20 minutes. So now this time, small t is given to us, that is 20, and capital T is unknown for us. So let's put that these values here. So ln 50 by 100 minus T is equal to 20 by 5 ln of 5 by 4. Now this is actually simpler because this is 4 times ln 5 by 4 is equal to ln of 50 by 100 minus T. So ln of 50 by 100 minus T is equal to ln of 5 by 4 to the power of 4. Right? So 50 by 100 minus T is roughly 1.25 to the power of 4. So T will be 100 minus 50 divided by 1.25 to the power of 4. Whatever it comes out to be. Roughly how much is it? Let's check it. So 50 divided by 1.25 to the power of 4. That comes out to be roughly 20-ish, and minus 100 will give you 79.52. Okay, roughly 79.52 degree Fahrenheit. Is it fine? Now, don't worry about these calculation part. For that, all the required information would be provided to you. Here, I don't know. I was surprised to see that information not being given, but normally they give that information. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns with respect to this? So it's all about, you know, framing the differential equation and solving it. Anywhere, any place you feel left out, disconnected, please highlight. What was the second part answer again? Yes. And second part answer was this much. 79.52 degree Fahrenheit. Okay. All right. So with this, we now move on to the geometry based problems. Okay. 2D and 3D geometry based problems. As you can see, we are not taking many problems of a type, because I think if you're aware of the process, more or less, you have to follow the same thing for almost all type of questions. So one example is good enough. Okay, let's take this question. Find the equation of the curve, which is such that the area of the rectangle constructed on the abscissa of any point and the intercept of the tangent at this point on the y-axis is equal to 4. Okay. Read the question once again. If you are not very sure about what this question is saying, please read it a couple of times. The equation of the curve, which is such that the area of the rectangle constructed on the abscissa of any point and the intercept of the tangent at this point on the y-axis is equal to 4. Please send it to me. I'll clarify them. Siddhant, you can message to me what are the questions where you want clarification. Either I will send you a voice message or I will solve it and send it to you. Okay, Siddhant. Did you see the solution? I mean, first, all the DPPs we provide with the solution. So did you see the solution first? Okay, still you didn't get it, then you can send it to me. Aditya has a question. What does the constructed on the abscissa mean? Okay, now see, let's say there's a curve. I'll just draw a rough figure over here. Okay. Let's say this is here, this. Okay. And you're drawing a tangent at this point, and this point is cutting the y-axis at some point. So let me draw a tangent. Let's take the point here instead of there. Okay, let's say the point is here. Now, basically what they're saying is that if you make a triangle, a rectangle like this, this rectangle has, okay, area of 4 units. Is it fine? Now, from here on, you have to proceed further. I think I got an answer from Shitij. Okay, Shitij. Now, one of the major concerns that people show initially while solving the problem is that, sir, we normally write our equation in terms of small x and small y, right? That's the norm that we follow. But here the point is also taken as a small x and small y. So it looks very, you know, odd and incorrect also to write something like this. Y minus y is equal to dy by dx x minus x, correct? Because the point is also taken to be small x and small y. So please don't do this while you are writing it, else you will get yourself badly confused. Okay. So the better way here is, instead of using, see, you have already designated your unknown point to be small x, small y. So don't use the same notation while you are writing the equation of a tangent. So use capitals. Okay. That is what I suggest. So use capital X and capital Y to represent your generic X comma Y, or you can say your equations X comma Y. Okay. Now you are basically, finding what you are finding mod of, right? The Y intercept, whatever is the Y intercept of this with the X coordinate over here. So this length is X coordinate, isn't it? So X into whatever is the Y intercept coming out. So what is the Y intercept coming from this? You can obtain the Y intercept by putting your capital X as zero. Okay. So when you put your capital X as zero, you'll end up getting capital Y minus small y as dy by dx into negative x. In short, your y intercept becomes y minus x dy by dx. So as per the given problem, x times y minus x dy by dx is equal to 4 units. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. All right. So from here, I would end up actually getting x times y minus x dy by dx as plus minus 4. Okay. Let's account for both of them together by using plus minus 4 wherever we can. So this gives us xy minus x square dy by dx is equal to plus minus 4. Okay. So far, so good. No issues. All right. So can I divide with a negative x square throughout? So when I divide with negative x square throughout, I'll get minus y by x. And this will become, you can keep writing plus minus also, doesn't make a difference because both of them, you know, are taken care of. Some people do it separately also. Some people do not remove that plus minus sign, so that they don't do it twice, the same thing. Okay. Now, what kind of a differential equation is this? If I put a plus sign here and I put a negative 1 by x, doesn't it look like dy by dx is equal to py equal to q, where p and q both are functions of x or constants? Correct. So this is clearly an LDE. Okay. So what is the IF? IF will be e to the power integral of minus 1 by x dx, which is e to the power minus ln x, which is actually 1 upon x. Okay. So this is as good as y into 1 by x is integral of plus minus 4 by x cube. Is it fine? Okay, so this will give you plus minus, if I'm not mistaken, 2 by x square plus c. So y by x is equal to plus minus 2 by x square plus c. Any questions? Any questions, any concerns to highlight? Aditya, how did you get that hyperbola, rectangular hyperbola? And I think very similar, Shitij also got some kind of a weird expressions. Any mistake that you did while you were forming the differential equation? Okay. So differential equation itself was incorrect. Okay, anyways, is this fine? Any questions? Okay, we'll take one more. But before that, if you have any questions, if you want to copy down anything, please do so. Yes, Shitish, tell me. Any questions you have? Rectangle with area 2. Area. Send me the screenshot. Okay, send me the screenshot. We'll check on my WhatsApp. Yeah. Okay, so we'll take another question. Let's take this almost, a physics question that you probably would have done in your fluid dynamics chapter. Find the time required for a cylindrical tank of radius small r and height capital H to empty through a round hole of area A at the bottom. The flow through the hole is, according to the law, the velocity is k times under root 2 g ht. Ht is a function, height function with respect to time. I mean, it's a height at a given time t. Okay, Vt and Ht are respectively the velocity of flow through the hole and height above the hole at a time t. G is the acceleration due to gravity. Okay, so Shitij has sent me a photograph. One second. Yeah, so this that intercept the tangent at A point is meeting at 3, right? Okay, and the width of the rectangle is almost 1.3-ish. I mean, if I just look at by naked eyes. So doesn't it become a 4? How are you saying a 2? No. You didn't get the question properly. See, you made a tangent here, right? It met here, right? Okay, so basically you have to find out this area. That is 4, no? As per the diagram also. You were looking at some different area, I think. I think you were looking at ABCD area. Yes, correct. Sir, can you explain the last question? Last question means this question, the one which was before that. This one, the square one. Square one, no, it's a rectangle one, by the way. Yeah, see what it says. At a generic point x comma y, if I draw a tangent, it meets the y axis at some position. Okay. From there, if you make a triangle like this, which is basically having its, you can say width to be x and height of the triangle, or the, you can say this is the width and this is the length. So length of the triangle is the x coordinate of that given point P where you are sketching the tangent, and width is where this tangent is meeting the y axis. So what I did, I first assumed the equation of the tangent to be this. So where does it meet the y-axis? For that, capital X is made 0, which happened here. So I got y value as y minus small x dy by dx. So area of a triangle is length into width, which is x into this, and this is equal to 4. Of course, I've taken a mod because I don't want a negative answer to come out. So from there, I got this, and that led to a linear differential equation, which I solved by using my idea of linear differential equation. Where is the doubt in this case? Which part you did not understand? The part where you took mod. This part. Length into breadth is equal to area of the triangle. What is the doubt in this? Length is x, width is y minus x dy by dx. I did not take mod. So if you do not take mod, that doesn't mean my method is wrong and your method is right. You have to take mod. That's the learning. Right, Kiran? Why you didn't take mod? What if the product was negative? Right? So where is the part you didn't understand? Don't say I didn't do it the same way. You said you did not understand. Where is the part you didn't understand? Tell me that. You did not take mod, that is your mistake. But where you did not understand, that is something else. Okay, coming back to this question. No, you said no, you want me to explain some part. So explain means you want to know where is the lacking in your understanding, right? Okay, you wanted to see the solution. Okay. Okay, so I hope everybody would have experienced such kind of a question in your physics, fluid dynamics topic. Now, many of us know that when you're solving such kind of a question, you can use your equation of continuity, isn't it? Everybody knows the equation of continuity. A1 V1 is equal to A2 V2, right? That comes from the fact that the mass of liquid at any junction is conserved, right? Mass is neither created nor destroyed. So let's use whatever concept we know to crack this problem. Okay, so Aditya has given some response. Okay, anybody else? Okay, Pradyun. Only till 6, yes, Siddhant. Today only class is till 6. Once we are done with the application, we are done with the class also. Because you already had a class 3 hours in the morning, so I didn't want you to sit for another three and a half hours. Okay, so thing done. Okay, no need to write, type out the answer. Some of you are, you know, kind enough to type it out. It's okay. Don't take that. Don't bother yourself typing so much. See, first of all, can I say the rate at which the volume is decreasing here is the rate at which, okay, so the decrement of the volume from here plus the volume that comes out from here, that should be equal to zero, isn't it? Okay. Or in short, can I say pi r squared dh by dt is under root of k under root of 2gh. I'm not writing t in the bracket and all because it just confuses the viewers, because many times you think it's a product of h and t. Okay. Into the area of the whole. But remember, this is, there will be a negative sign over here. Okay. Why? Because this is the amount of water, volume of water flowing out per second from the hole. Right. So here, if you compare it directly with pi r square dh by dt, and dh by dt will be a negative quantity because height is reducing or decreasing with time. So you cannot say the volume of water gushing out of the hole where everything is positive over here, okay, is equal to a negative quantity. That would be, you know, as an equation, it would be an incorrect way to represent. So you have to put a negative sign over here. Now, this is a clear cut variable separable. Once again, I can say dH by root H is K into under root 2G into A by pi R square. You can put a negative sign. Okay. And dt, of course. Now here you can do a simple activity. Remember, the height was initially capital H and you want it to become zero. And here, let's say t equal to zero. And at time capital T, it basically empties completely. That means the cylindrical tank is totally empty at capital T time. Okay, so you can directly use your definite integrals concept over here, right? So this is simple. Let's do this. So this is h to the power minus half plus 1
by minus 0.5 plus 1 is 0.5.
Yeah, so sorry about that. So this becomes if I'm not mistaken, 2 under root of h. Okay. And you can observe the negative sign here and put it from 0 to capital H. This will be capital T minus 0. Okay. So 2 under root H, you can, you know, write it like K under root 2G into area by pi R square T. So it becomes a super easy question. It becomes 2 under root h into pi r square by k under root 2g a. Is it fine? Now the very same question, let us say somebody gives you in the form of, not as a cylinder, but gives you in the form of a semi spherical tank or hemispherical tank. Okay. And he gives that the height of the tank initially, height of water in the tank initially is equal to the radius. And again, there is a similar type of a hole there from where the water is basically, you know, leaking. Okay. So the question can be framed in any structure. All you need to do is carefully figure out this differential equation that you have formed initially. Here it was quite simple, but if I make the structure of a cylindrical tank to be a hemispherical tank, then what all changes will happen? Please try this out as a question. So think as if this hole is of area A. Okay. Again, the water is coming out at a rate of, let's say, you know, K under root of 2GH, H being the height, instantaneous height at time T. Okay. So let's say this is your small h. Okay. Fine. Not now, as a homework. Okay. And then figure out what is the time required for tank to empty. For tank to empty. Okay. So please try this out for a homework question. As a homework. Siddhant, when I'm writing something, you should focus on copying that part down rather than worrying about something which has already been written. Right? So I'm giving you a question to work out for your homework. Isn't it any less important? Is this any less important than what you have done? In fact, you will be surprised to know this question came, I think, in JEE 2001. This question which I'm giving you. Okay. Yeah, please, when I'm saying something, when I'm explaining something, don't worry about copying something which has been already written. So I'm giving you a question that you have to solve for a homework. So just note that down first, then we'll come back to whatever you want to copy. No, 2001, there was no mains. Yeah, you can say the mains that time was JEE Advanced. Near about 2006, there used to be separate prelims round and the advanced round. So advanced round used to be called as JEE main exam. Yes, so it has gone a lot of name changes. IIT JEE exam, then they made it the JEE Advanced exam. So currently the name that we have, we got it post, I think, 2008 or 9, I believe. Before that, they used to say IIT JEE exam. And even before that, they used to call it as, you know, JEE main exam, and there used to be a prelims exam. So what main exam you have written used to be the prelims. And JEE main exam used to be the advance of now. Okay, so this came in JEE advance equivalent to now. Yes, they have made the name slightly sound scarier. Okay. Fine, copied. Everybody done? Any questions? Okay. So now we'll move on. In fact, I think we can take one more question on this, because geometry based questions are very important type. Let's take this one. I hope you can read this written in small font, but I think you can read it. Given the curves y equal to f of x passing through 0, 1 and y equal to minus infinity to x f of t passing through 0, 1/2, the tangent drawn to both the curves at the point with equal abscissa intersect on the x-axis. Then you have to find the f of x curve. Do you want me to run the poll? Okay, let me launch the poll at least so that I keep the idea of the time also gone. The tangent drawn to both the curves at the point with equal abscissa intersect on the x-axis. Okay, excellent. I've got one response in near about 1 minute. Yeah, Kshitij. If you want to change your answer, you can change it by typing it out on the chat box, which answer you think is correct. If at all by mistake you have pressed something which you feel is incorrect and you figure it out later, you can message me on the chat box that I feel this is the right answer. Because anyways, I don't get to see who has voted for which option. Okay, so far 9 people have answered. It's almost 4 minutes. I can give you one more minute as of now, and then we'll discuss it out because we have few more concepts left to be covered. I don't want to run myself out of time, giving too much time to this question. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. All right. So most of you have said option number C. Okay. Most of you have said option number C. Let's check it out. See, let's talk about the first curve, y is equal to f of x curve. Okay. And let's say I'm drawing the tangent at a point x comma y. So what's the equation of the tangent? Equation of tangent at x comma y. So let's write down the equation of the tangent, which is going to be capital Y minus small y is equal to f dash x capital X minus small x. Okay. Now for the other curve, I'm drawing the tangent at such a point which has got equal abscissa. Okay. So let's say the curve that has been given to me, I'm calling it by the name of, okay, let's keep it this only. So let's say this is my curve. Okay. Sorry to see that they have missed out a DT over there. Okay. So now you are basically drawing a tangent at a point X comma, let's say Y1. Okay. So equation of tangent drawn at X comma Y1. Okay. Is what capital Y minus Y1. Okay. Equal to derivative of this function. What is dy by dx at X comma Y1? Can I say it will be f of X only? Correct? By Leibniz rule. So if you differentiate this with respect to X, right? We have to put X in place of T into derivative of X, then minus infinity in place of T, or at least T tending to minus infinity, but derivative of minus infinity being a constant will be zero. Correct. So in place of T, I'll be putting an X, and that gives me the expression for the dy by dx at X comma Y1. Isn't it? Any questions here? Okay. Now the question says the tangent drawn, they both meet each other on the x-axis. Okay, great. So let us first put capital Y equal to 0 over here and see what is my capital X coming out. So when I put capital Y is equal to 0, my capital X will come out to be this divided by this, and X will go there. Okay, yeah. So it'll become X minus Y upon F dash X. Right. Similarly, if I put capital Y equal to 0 here, let's say what does capital X come out to be? Everything will come out to be the same. It's just that you have a Y1 in place of Y, and you will have F of X in place of F dash. Okay. Now, since they're meeting at the same point, these two values are equal, right? So they should be same because they're meeting at the same point on the X axis. So the X coordinate of the point of intersection would be the same. In short, what are you saying? You're saying small x minus y by f dash x is small x minus y1, okay, by f of x. In short, minus minus also goes. In short, you'll have end up something like this. F dash x by f of x is equal to y by y1. Am I right? Yes or no? Okay. Now, y by y1, what do you understand by y by y1? Let's say I call this by some name. Instead of writing a y, I call it as gx. Okay. I call this as gx. So can I say y by y1 y by y1 is as good as saying g dash x by gx. Because this y is also satisfying this condition. See, this y1 is what? This y1 is satisfying this curve, right? No, I think, one second. This will become, one second, this small correction here. See, this y1 is coming from g of x. And this y is coming from f of x, isn't it? Correct. So it is y is f of x by y1 g of x. Sorry about that. Yeah, correct. Yes or no? See, this y that you had taken, this y is basically satisfying this property, right? At that x, y is f of x, isn't it? So this y that I had over here, after I remove everything, let's say I remove these, yeah. This y, I change it to f of x, okay? And y1 is this curve, right? Y1 is a point which is satisfying this curve, right? So y1 is actually your g of x. So this y1 is your g of x. Okay. So far, so good. Any questions so far? Okay. And yes, you are right. F of x is g dash x. Now it has come like this. Okay. Initially, I jumped onto this, but now it is clear. Okay. So once you have got it, you can now apply integral on both the sides with respect to x. Okay, so you can integrate both sides with respect to x. And this gives you ln of f of x is equal to ln of g of x. Okay. Correct? Any confusion or any questions so far? Okay, and we need to add a constant of integration, correct? Okay, so after this, what should we do? We already know, we also know the fact that g dash x is your f of x, right? G dash x, the derivative of this is your f of x. Can we use that? Can we use that? Can we use this information somewhere? Okay, fine. So, okay, this step is obvious. Okay. Then what else? What else? Right. So from here, I can say g dash x by g of x is again a constant. Correct? Which means if I integrate it once again, can I not say ln of g of x becomes c of x plus a k? In short, I can say g of x becomes, sorry for that crooked handwriting once again. Yeah. Can I say g of x will become k e to the power cx? Okay. Now, please note, many of us, we fail to see that this is actually this. That is e to the power k into e to the power cx, where e to the power a can be written as a k. It is anyways a constant of integration. Correct? Yes or no? So if this is g of x, what is f of x? F of x is the derivative of this term, which is k c e to the power kx. Now let us use some information provided to us with respect to the point. We already know that the function f of x passes through 0, 1, right? Which means this is 1 when x is 0. That means kc is equal to 1. Let's call it as the one set of information. And we also know that g passes through 0, 1/2. So here in this, if I put half and this is 0, k becomes half, isn't it? So if k becomes half, c becomes 2 as per this condition. Okay. So when c becomes 2 and k becomes half, your f of x, that is what they're asking us, your f of x will actually become 1 e to the power 2, sorry, k is half. Oh, sorry, this is c, not k. This is c. So it becomes 1 e to the power cx. Cx is 2x, which means your function f of x, let me write it on the side. Your function f of x becomes e to the power of 2x, which is clearly option number C. Option number C is correct. Okay, so I'll repeat once again what all I did. Yeah, you could have scammed it, but my purpose is not to tell you a shortcut. My purpose is to rigorously solve it. See, once we got this stage, okay, what we did, we basically integrated both the sides and we ended up getting this. Again, let me remind you, instead of C, I could have written ln C also, doesn't make a difference. Fine. And now I use the fact that f of x is g dash x. So here I replace g dash once again, brought this g of x down, integrated both sides with respect to x once again, which led to this expression. Okay. Many times we can write ln k also here. So from here, I ended up g of x as k times e to the power cx. So f of x being derivative of g, f of x will come out to be this. Of course, I've used differentiation of an exponential function. Now, once we have got this, we got our k and c from the boundary conditions provided to you in the question. That means your g was passing through 0, 1/2. So when you put x as 0, g of 0 becomes half. So half is equal to k. And from here, I ended up getting, again, 1 is equal to kc. So c became a 2. So k is half, c is 2. So kc is 1, e to the power 2x. That finally leads your function to be e to the power 2x. Good enough. Any questions here? All right. So now we'll take up a dilution question. Dilution, you can say application. So another application of differential equation in dilution based problem. Dilution problems. Okay. Now, let me first give you a scenario. Okay. I'll give you a scenario and we will try to frame a differential equation on that scenario. We'll not solve it. We'll solve it when there is an actual figure provided to us. Okay. So let us say there is a tank. Okay. This tank is filled up with some solution. Let's say it is filled up with brine. Okay. We all know brine is a concentrated solution of sodium chloride, right? Is my chemistry good enough? Okay. So this is a tank which is full of, you know, it is filled, it has brine in it. And let's say there are V0 liters of, okay. So this volume of this tank is V0 liters of brine in it. Okay. And you can say the amount of salt which has been put into this is, let's say, 8 kgs. Okay. So putting 8 kg of salt in V0 liters of water, you have created a brine solution like this. Okay. So 8 kg of salt is being put. Fine. Now this tank, there is a hole at the bottom of this tank. Okay. And through this, the brine solution leaves at the rate of, you can say, F liters per minute. Okay. So through this hole in the tank, the brine solution, which was already in the tank, leaves at the rate of F liters per minute. Okay. Now, at the same time, you are pouring in fresh, you know, brine solution, which has been, you know, which has got the concentration as, let's say, B kgs per liter. Okay. And you're pouring it at a rate of, let's say, E liters per minute. Okay. So there is a fresh brine, another brine solution. And this brine solution basically has the concentration of brine as B kgs per liter. And you are pouring in, this is the rate at which you are pouring in, a rate of pouring, which is E liters per minute. Okay. Write a differential equation. What will be the ordinary differential equation for Q? Q being the amount of salt in that tank at a given time t. Amount of salt at time t. So write an OD for rate of, let me write it like this, for rate of change of Q. Which is the amount of salt. Q is the amount of salt. Okay. So what is the, how would you write an expression for dQ by dt? Yes, only for the amount of salt. So you have to write the differential equation for the rate of change of the amount of salt. Okay, in terms of the given parameters given to you, in terms of whatever V0, A, F, B, E, whatever you want to use from there. So remember, two things are happening. There was already a solution of brine, okay, V0 volume containing 8 kg of salt, and F, you can say F liters per minute brine solution is lost from the tank, but at the same time you are pouring in E liters per minute of another brine solution whose concentration is B kgs per liter. Okay, let's write down. Okay, we'll check out Kinshuk whether your response is correct or not. See, let's talk about, let Q be the amount of salt present in the solution. Amount of salt at time t. Okay. What will be the volume? What will be the volume at time t? Let's say V is the volume at time t. Volume of brine in the tank at time t. So what will be the volume? So you can see that V naught was the initial volume. You are losing water at the rate of, you're losing brine at the rate of F liters per minute. So FT will reduce, but you are still pouring in at the rate of ET. So this will be the volume at a given time T. So can I say the amount of salt that you are adding is BE per unit time, but you are losing at a rate of the amount of salt per unit volume into F. Do you all agree with me on this or not? Okay. So your final expression would look like this. dQ by dt is BE minus QF by V0 plus E minus F times T. So this is the differential equation that will get formed. Now, of course, I will provide you with a question where you would be given B, E, you know, all those F, V naught, etc. Then you can solve this equation by whatever technique you feel like. So this is how, see, what is my purpose here? My purpose here is to just, you know, explain you how to frame the differential equation for this dilution process, which is happening. Dilution or concentration depends upon which is more, B is more or E is more. So we'll talk about you know, this in terms of numbers. Okay. Any question with respect to framing it? Y plus, Y minus, everything is clear. So this is helping to increase the concentration. This is helping us to decrease the concentration because we are losing this amount of salt. You're gaining this amount of salt. See, when you are pouring in the solution, this BE term is clear, right, Kinshuk? Okay. Now let's say Q is the amount of salt. So if you divide salt by volume, so this will be the kgs per liter salt. And you're losing it at a rate of F liters per minute. So this amount of salt will leave the tank. So this amount of salt enters the tank per unit time. Okay. And this amount of salt, whole thing, will leave the tank. The salt leaves the tank. So you have to subtract. Okay. We'll take one small question based on this, very simple one. Q by that is the density. Yes, you can say the concentration. And F is the volume that you're losing out. So overall, it gives you a, you know, this becomes amount of salt per unit time. Let's take a question. I hope you can read this question. Maybe it's written in a small font. Okay, I'll put it here. See, this question says a 50 gallon tank. Okay, they have used units of gallon, no issues. Gallon and okay, my volume was in liter. This is in gallon, doesn't make any difference. So a 50 gallon tank initially contains 10 gallon of fresh water at t equal to zero. A brine solution containing 1 pound of salt per gallon is poured into the tank at the rate of 4 gallons per minute, while the well-stirred mixture leaves the tank at the rate of 2 gallons per minute. They have asked two parts in this question. One is the amount of time required for overflow to occur. And the amount of salt in the tank at the moment of overflow. Now, many of the students ask me, sir, in this differential equation, there is no A being used. You also talked about the A being present here. How do you plan to use this A? Or is this A immaterial to us? Can you tell me why, where that A would be, you know, taken into consideration? Right. So basically that A is actually the amount of concentration or Q value at T equal to zero. So please, you know, use that to get your C value. Exactly, Aditya. Absolutely right. So, okay. So without much waste of time, let's figure it the data. Just plug in the data here. What is BE? Can I say, as per this data, B is one. This is your B value. So let me put those expressions here. B is one, E is four, because you're pouring the brine solution, the freshly prepared brine solution at a rate of 4 gallons per minute. What is F? What is F? F is two because 2 gallons per minute is leaving the solution. Okay. And V naught, initially there was 10 gallons of water. So V naught is your 10 only. Okay. So as per the expression, will be V minus QF, F is 2Q, by 10 plus E minus F. E minus F is 2T. E minus F T. Okay. In short, you ended up getting a solution. You ended up getting a differential equation, not solution, differential equation, which is actually a, what kind of a differential equation is this? Can you, let me write it like this. 1 by 5 plus T Q equal to 4. What kind of a differential equation is this? LD. Okay, good enough. All right. So if this is an LD, let's find out our IF. Integrating factor is e to the power integral of 1 by 5 plus t dt. That's going to be e to the power ln of 5 plus t, which is 5 plus t. Okay. So Q into 5 plus t is equal to integral of 4 5 plus t dt. So this gives us Q into 5 plus t is equal to 20t plus 2t square. Am I right? Put a constant of integration. Now put the value of Q as 0 because A is 0. Okay. At t equal to 0. So this gives us C value as 0 itself, if I'm not mistaken. That means Q expression is 20t plus 2t square upon 5 plus t. Now, they're asking us two things here. What is the time that it will take for the tank to overflow? Okay. That part is very simple. You have 50 gallons of 50 gallon tank, which 10 gallon of fresh water, right? And you can see the net influx is 2, right? So already there is 10 gallon and there is a net influx of 2. So when will this touch 50? So answer is 20. Correct. So in 20 minutes, your tank will start overflowing. So first part of the answer is done. Is it fine? Because you need to have 50 gallons altogether. Initially, there was 10 gallons and the water was coming, the inrush of water was at a rate of 2 gallons per minute, because 4 was the one with 4 gallons. With 4 gallons you're putting in, 2 gallons is leaving out. So there's a surplus of 2 gallons per minute. Okay. So now once T is 20 minutes, they're asking you, what is the volume of the salt? What is the quantity of the salt? So you can put your value of T as a 20. So 2 into 20 square upon 25. How much does it give you? I think we can cancel off a lot of terms here without evaluating it. So this is 400 by 25. 400 by 25 is going to be 16. And this is 2 into 400 by 25. 16 again. 48 pounds of salt will be there. At the time of overflow, there will be 48 pounds of salt in the tank. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. So I would like to do one question on electrical circuits with you that you're already aware of. I don't have to tell you the Kirchhoff's voltage law, etc. for any kind of a circuit related problem. If this is fine, I can move on to the next. All right. So let's take this question. There is an RC circuit. An RC circuit has an EMF given in volts as 400 cos 2t, a resistance of 100 ohm and a capacitance of 10 to the power minus 2 farad. Okay. So R and C values are given and it has got an EMF also connected in the circuit. Initially, there is no charge on the capacitor. Find the current in the circuit at any time t. Find the current in the circuit at any time t. So the situation is basically like this. You have a resistance, you have a capacitance, and you have a time-dependent voltage source, which is 400 cos 2t. R is 100 ohm. And this is 10 to the power minus 2 farad, which is actually very large value. Farads, normally capacitance are in microfarads. Anyhow, so we have to find out what is the current in the circuit at any time t. Okay, I being the current, IR. Okay, is equal to Q by C, is equal to the EMF. Correct? Can I write it like this? Okay, R itself is 100 and Q itself, sorry, I itself is dQ by dt. So basically we have this. Okay. So this is going to give us dQ by dt plus Q by 100 C. 100 C is equal to 4 cos 2t. This will also get cancelled off because they are same values. And this gives you a plain and simple, linear differential equation. Correct. Now, why did I write it in terms of Q? Because I know the initial condition on charge, there was no charge on the capacitor. That means at t equal to zero, Q was zero. Okay. So instead of writing an integral sign over here, I wrote I in terms of dQ by dt. Right? So instead of integral I dt, I wrote Q by C. Now, this is simple to solve. IF over here will be what? E to the power integral of 1 dt, which is e to the power t. Okay? So Q into e to the power t is integral of 4 e to the power t cos 2t. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns so far? Now, this is of the type e to the power ax cos bx. So what is the solution here? E to the power t by 5. Okay, correct me if I'm wrong. It's 2 sine 2t plus cos 2t. Is it fine? Any questions? Of course, put a C at the end. Now, use the fact that Q is zero. Q is zero when T is zero. Q is zero when T is zero, right? So you have put T as zero and Q as zero both. So that gives us C value as -4/5. So put it back over here. So I end up getting Q as, by the way, I'll just write it in one shot. I divide by e to the power t. So if I divide by e to the power t, I'll get something like this. And C was -4/5. So e to the power -2 - t will become. Okay, correct me if I'm wrong, correct? Now they're asking us for the current. Current will be nothing but derivative of this charge. So that's going to be 4/5. This is going to be 4 cos 2t -2 sin 2t. And this will be +4/5 e to the power -t. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? So this will be your answer for the charge at any time t in the circuit. A current at any time t in the circuit. Any questions, any concerns? Okay. With this, normal method means what normal method? Which normal method you're talking about? See, have you ever solved question where there is a forced EMF? Okay. In that you don't get a exponential function. Yeah, of course, phasors and all will come into picture. Exactly. Yeah, so exponential function will come anyhow. Okay. So before I leave, I would like you to take a question as a homework because time is almost over. So one question I will give you for a homework maybe. Okay, you can try this out. I don't know whether I have taken that question into account. Let me just check on the system. Okay, I'll just write down the question here itself. Simple question. I mean, you would have done many of these questions as your physics question. So there is a mass, 2 kg mass, which is dropped, okay, with no initial velocity. No initial velocity. So it's a free fall. Okay. This mass experiences an air resistance. This mass experiences an air resistance, which is directly proportional to the square of the velocity. So V is the velocity at a time t. Okay. So square of the instantaneous velocity directly proportional to that. Or let me just remove this thing. It experiences air resistance, which is equal to V square. Okay. Let me make the life simple. Find the velocity of the body at time t. find the velocity of the body at time t. You would like to do it now, or would you like to do it at a homework? You can tell me. Now, okay. I didn't give you that proportionality constant. I removed it so that your answer doesn't come out in terms of the proportionality constant. That's it. Okay. If you want to do it now, we can do it. So everybody first frame a differential equation and let me know once you're done with the framing of the differential equation quickly. Take GS10 if you want. Okay. Take acceleration due to gravity exactly as 10 meter per second square. So what is the differential equation that you will be forming? M dv by dt is equal to mg minus v square. M is already given to you as a 2. So dv by dt is equal to g is 10 minus v square by 2. Am I right? Now this is not even you can do this as a variable separable. That's so easy. So this is going to be, if I'm not mistaken, 2 dv by 20 minus v square is equal to dt. Hope I'm not missing out anything. Okay. So this is 2 dv root of 20 square minus v square is equal to dt. So integrate both sides. So this is of the nature a square minus x square. So a square minus x square is 1 by 2a ln a plus x a minus x equal to t plus c. Now use the fact that t equal to zero, velocity was also zero. Okay. So t equal to zero, velocity also zero will make it ln 1. So everything will become a zero. So c will also become a zero. So 1 by 2 root 5 ln 2 root 5 minus v by 2 root 5 plus v by 2 root 5 minus v is equal to t. Okay. Now, the task is on you to now convert this right v in terms of t. That's it. Because they have asked, I think, what is the find velocity at time t. So you have to write v as a function of time. Okay. So with this, we happily conclude the chapter. And before you disperse, I have a very important announcement to make. Last week, again, we will have the last session on our regular class. So Thursday, next Thursday and Friday. Okay. That is the only 2 days when we will have a regular session. I think, since you will have school and school exams will be going on, we cannot have any extra session. One of the days, maybe I think Friday or Thursday, I will let you know. So this is a combined batch. Everybody will be there. So even HSR people who used to come on just on Friday for maths, you will be coming on Thursday. And Rajaji Nagar people used to come on Thursday only, you will come for Friday as well. So both the days will be the combined classes. Okay. And in these 2 days, we will try as much as possible to finish off AUC, area under curves, and vectors 3D. By the way, this can be done easily because it requires only one class. This requires more classes as told by Kiran sir to me. Okay.